Well, for me, standing on stage at the Michigan in front of all of my friends from the gym, and in what I say made such a fool of myself on stage, which I didn't make a complete fool of myself, but my standards, it wasn't there. You know, the Miss Olympia was never, that wasn't really the goal at the time. I'm always amazed when I meet competitors and they come up to me, and although I'm really flattered, and then they say, you know, I want to compete in, I want to be Miss Olympia. And they say, I want to be Miss Olympia. And I think, and knowing what I know, I always think, wow, you know, just put one foot in front of the other. It's great to have that goal. Yes, that's the ultimate. And for me, Corey Everson at the time, she was on the scene, and she was just like incredible. And so that world was so big for me. I really was just putting one foot in front of the other. It was about the Michigan. It was about winning the Miss Michigan. That was all that mattered to me.
And now let's keep this in perspective, because the Miss Michigan at that time, in the late 80s, had 80 women competitors.
Yes.
You didn't have four or five people in the whole class. You had four classes of 20 people, correct?
Yes, correct.
And there were big pose downs, and there were big, those were contests, right?
Yes, those were contests. And bodybuilding for women, I mean, it was incredible. It was a big show. And that's where my focus, I had to get past the Michigan, past those competitors. And it took me about 4 years before I learned and grasped what it took to step on stage and to win the Michigan. So that was the most, that was important to me. That's what I wanted, the state title. And my thoughts after that were the Great Lakes Championships. And I wasn't thinking about the Junior Nationals until I got past the Great Lakes. I really took it from the state to regional to the Junior Nationals. I didn't go past the Junior Nationals and go straight to the Nationals like I see a lot of competitors, you know, do. So
touching, like you said, knowing what you know now, would you take that same path, or would you try and just jump into, like people are talking now, I just want to be Miss Olympia.
Yeah, yeah.
Would you take that same one of time path? I mean, knowing what you know.
Yeah, especially today, I would say take that one step at a time. You're, you know, you just, I think it's crazy to, in some cases you have a few competitors that can leave and the Michigan and then go straight to the Nationals, but they really don't understand. We all come to this with a very naive, you know, understanding of how it works, and
it's like a pop star. They make a record and they think they're going to be a, you know, billionaire, right?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah.
They think that. It's just not the case. So one step at a time, one foot in front of the other. Don't jump, because the judges on a national level, they have to kind of see you and know you. And if you go to the Junior Nationals and you win the Junior Nationals, and then you go and step on the stage at the USA or the Nationals, the judges say, oh, yeah, I remember her. She won the Junior Nationals. That's just the way it is.
So how many times, how much did that take at that time? Because you made a really quick ascent.
Yeah.
Yeah, you went from Michigan State champion to the Junior Nationals to pro within two shows or something. What was it exactly?
Yeah, I went from when I won the Miss Michigan, that same year I went to the Great Lakes Championships. So I won the Michigan, I think, in June, then I went to the Great Lakes Championships in like October, and that was in 1988. And then in 1989, in the summer, I competed in the Junior Nationals, won the Junior Nationals, and then in the fall, I went on to the North American where I turned pro, and turn pro, and then from the North American, the next year is where I went into the Miss Olympia and won the Miss Olympia. Well, the difference is that, and that's where I think that competitors, when they say, and they're amateur, and then they say they want to be a professional, is that we come to this place with, we're really naive, and but our hearts are pure, and we love competing, and that's all we know is competing. And so you think, you know, if I'm the best and I win this show, then that means that I will get this and that. I'll get great sponsors, I'll be on the cover of Muscle and Fitness, I can quit my day job, and now, you know, I'm a pro, and all these things are going to happen. And that's not true. That's not the way it works. When you turn pro, you no longer fill out an entry form to compete in Arnold's show or in the Miss Olympia. You have to be invited. You have to be invited. And even if you win the USA Championships and you're the best amateur, now it's about business. It's a business. And you're no longer a number. You're not number 89. Now you're Lyndon Murray. And you have to establish yourself as a professional. What is it about you that stands out? What are you bringing to the table? What's your market? What do you really bring to the table? Mm-hmm. Are you great? Are you beautiful? Are you a great poser? Do they want you on the covers? Or how are you going to make them money? How are you going to make them money? Right. Period.
Marketability. So with that, you're a great ambassador. For what reason? Now, no. Don't be humble about it, because
right.
We know yeah. Lenda Murray, and how I still tell the story of how you send me Christmas cards. You're a real person. You're a
yes.
genuine person.
Yes.
You're, what you see is what you get, and that's very important, and a lot of people lose that when they get fame or fortune or anything else. So do you think that was your best asset at the time, is your both likability and charisma?
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely. I, without question, I know that, and it's likability. It's the fact that, you know, my heart, the fact that I did come to the sport with just really loving people and loving the sport. And I had to get, like, hit upside the head a couple times to kind of, like, try to get in the flow that this is a business. And sometimes my feelings would get hurt because I didn't really understand. I'm like, wow, I'm a nice person. I love people. I love the sport. Isn't that what this is about? But then you start to meet the people that are in charge, and they're like, hey, it's about selling magazines, Lenda. I love you. I think you're really nice. You're great. But I have to sell this magazine, and I have to know that if I put you on the cover, that this magazine is going to sell in Alabama, it's going to sell in Nevada, in LA, and in Michigan, you know, so.
And truth to the matter is, you can still be on a magazine cover and still sell those magazine covers, right?
Oh, that's right, absolutely, I can.
That's right.
I can, yes. I know that what helped me, once I won the Miss Olympia, personality, that it was important, it was major, and I did get a lot of, being a cheerleader at Western Michigan University, being a cheerleader for the USFL, that did help me a lot, because that teaches you to, you know, deal with people. It's about performing, it's about dealing with people, making people happy.
Get their attention, make them happy, right?
Make them happy. So that was a major asset for me. It really was. I see women come to the sport and they win the title. And a matter of fact, you know, after I won the Miss Olympia, And I was in the game, and I kind of had a little bit of an understanding of some of the basics as far as like my personality, as far as other competitors. And there would be a girl coming up in the amateurs, and they'd say, there's this girl, she just won the USA, she's a great physique, and you gotta see her. And at that point, I knew that she had to have more than just a great physique. And so I didn't concern myself with what she looked like. You know, I'd see a picture of her, and I said, okay, now I want to meet her. I want to hear about her after this win, how she interacts with the people in the business. Is she the type of person, she have a bad attitude? And if she has a bad attitude, and if she pisses off the wrong person, she'll never beat me. And that's just the way it is. It's just the way it is. So personality and your behavior, the way you deal with people, is very important in this sport.
The way you carry yourself, the way you sign autographs and all that stuff, right?
Absolutely, it's very important. My tips for being a great pro, to me a great pro is a person that, first of all, like, I have such great respect for amateurs because, like I said, all you do is you worry about your training, your diet, and being the best. A great pro comes to the stage in great shape. They're consistent at being in great shape. A great pro is one that, again, personality is very important. And I think what you do in the off season, as an amateur in the off season meant eating ice cream, cake, cookies, getting fat. It meant going back to your old ways. As a pro, all year long, it's important to try to stay in some type of good shape.
Right. Always on.
Trying to be always on and being prepared, because now you have to do guest appearances. So it's not about you have to be able to get on the plane and still cook your food and take it with you. You have to have the ability to still train consistently. Even if you're away and you're in Nebraska, you still have to train. And to not lose sight, you want to still have the heart of an amateur. But at the same time, you have to learn how to deal with people. You have to learn how to drop what you're doing. There's a lot of sacrifices in regards to your family. So it's...
So through the successive wins, was it still as rewarding to go from the second time to the third time to the fourth time? I mean, was each as equally good for you? I'm sure the first win was always the best win.
Yes.
But then after that, was it like, you just felt, how did you feel after so many successful wins?
Yeah.
People, they can't fathom that.
Yeah.
People come in there, they win maybe twice.
Yes.
You won all those, eight times. It's not just a fluke. It's not like you got lucky, right?
Yes, correct.
So how is that feeling? I mean, you must have felt like you were on top of the world, but how did you stay humble at the same time?
Yeah. That first win, incredible. And I always just, again, the same approach, put one foot in front of the other. I wasn't like thinking to myself, I want to do what Corey Everson did. I wasn't thinking, I want to win 6 Miss Olympias. So that first one was really tough. After the first one, it was major tough. If I had to say what Miss Olympia was the hardest, it was the second. Because then I had to really come into like I'm Miss Olympia. And
everybody's gunning for you, man.
Everybody's gunning for me. And not only are they all gunning for me, it was I had this pressure on me. for the first time. Because before, nobody cared when I was training for my first Miss Olympia. Matter of fact, people thought, oh, you know, you'll do okay. Nobody thought I was going to win the Miss Olympia, you know, and nobody cared. And then at the second Miss Olympia, everything changed. Really, my family somewhat changed, you know. Everybody wanted to go. They want tickets. They were all in the way, in my space. You know, I'm training. I can't train in peace anymore. And so, but at the same time, I wanted to, and that's why I stayed in Michigan. I stayed home. I did not pick up my bags and move to Los Angeles. I was asked to move to Los Angeles, and I said, no, I'm staying home. I think that really helped a lot, is to stay home, stay with family, stay with friends.
You'll be grounded, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's not broke. I'm not going to try to fix it. So I stayed home.